for your Moodle credentials very soon so that you can enroll in the course. Okay, now that being said, let us start. So, as I said, in this lecture today, we want to understand that how my orthotropic material will behave if the environment in which they operate changes. So, volume changes in the absence of surface tractions are known as expansional strains. They can be caused by changes in temperature or absorption of some swelling agent like water or solvent, or some dissolved gases get somehow, the dissolved gas inside the composite material, somehow they start getting expanded. This will lead to what is known as residual stress. To understand what is residual stress, imagine that you have a fiber and the matrix. The fiber's coefficient of expansion is different than the coefficient of expansion of the matrix, but they are glued together. Let us say the coefficient of expansion for the matrix is higher than the fiber. So what is going to happen? The fiber is going to want to expand less due to the temperature, and the matrix is wanting to expand more, but both of them are glued. So the matrix will suffer from some compression and the fiber will suffer from some tension due to the traction continuity. That is an example of how residual stresses will work in the context of composite materials. Okay. In such cases, the generalized Hooke's law to account for expansional strains takes this form, where I have strain is equal to, this is your, this term you already understand, compliance into stress, plus strain due to thermal effects, plus strain due to hygroscopic effects, plus dot, 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 as many effects as you want can be added up. Okay, so we are making the assumption that these strains can be added one by one. So the principle of linear superposition holds true for strain. Okay, so what do we want to do? We want to introduce hygrothermal effects into my constitutive equation so that later on when I'm doing more elaborate developments into my mesomechanics, I can take use of it. So, and before we go further, one thing that you must keep in mind is what is, so temperature, all of you know what temperature is, but what is concentration of humidity? Concentration of humidity is defined as mass of water volume delta V divided by mass of dry composite in volume delta V, where delta V tends to zero. This is how we will define concentration of humidity. This dry composite actually could be dry material, dry orthotropic material also. This definition holds true. And we want to consider all four configurations. All four configurations means that what happens if all temperature, coefficient of hygroscope, stress is zero, what happens if one of them is not zero, etc., etc. So what is the effect of only thermal? What is the effect of only hygroscopic? What is the effect of all three combined? What is the effect of mechanical loads that we applied? So all different configurations our proposed model should be able to account for. So the thermal and hygroscopic strains are given by this equation, that strain, thermal strain, epsilon I superscript T, is equal to alpha I delta T, where alpha I is the coefficient of thermal expansion. Similarly, hygroscopic strain is epsilon I H into beta I delta C. Now, you will notice that so far in your course or in your mechanics of solids, whenever you have learned that thermal strain is equal to alpha delta T. Can anybody tell me why I have written alpha subscript I? Anybody? No?
This coefficient will be different in different directions.
Correct. Yes. So, because so far you were learning only isotropic materials. Now we are trying to do a generalized formulation of these factors in orthotropic material. And in orthotropic material, just like stiffness and compliance can be different in different directions, the coefficient of thermal expansion or the coefficient of hygroscopic strain can also be different in different directions. So we have to put a subscript I. Okay.
Sir, we are not able to see the slides. We are seeing only one slide.
So, which slide are you seeing? This is slide number?
We are seeing only slide number one.
I mean, is everybody in slide number one? I'm in slide three.
Now it came, sir.
Okay. So let us keep it like this, I think. So let me repeat. So the hygroscopic and thermal strains are given by epsilon I T superscript alpha I delta T. And hygroscopic is sigma I subscript H beta I delta C. Alpha and beta are the coefficients of thermal expansion and hygroscopic expansion respectively. This subscript I that you see below alpha is given because our material, we can no longer assume it to be isotropic. So far you learned that thermal strain was alpha delta T. However, for an orthotropic material, you also have to specify which component of strain, and the direction is also important. In different directions, the coefficient of thermal expansion can be different. Okay, now we are writing our stiffness form of the constitutive equation in inverted form. It will come out to be something like this, where epsilon is the total strain minus thermal strain minus hygroscopic strain bracket into stiffness is the strain. Okay, in our first slide we learned that total strain is the sum of multiple strains. We want to find out now the value expression for the mechanical strain or the stress, sorry, not mechanical, the stress. So for that, sigma, all these terms are taken to your left hand side, and we are getting relationship between stress and strain, which comes out to be something like this. Now it is consistent. Now all of you are seeing slide number three. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Another important point to keep in mind is that for orthotropic materials, if you choose the coordinate axis system in terms of your orthotropy, then pre-expansion will only produce normal strains. So this coefficient of thermal expansion or hygroscopic expansion coefficient will not lead to shear strain. And like was defined for stiffness, if a material is transversely isotropic in the 1-2 plane, then strain in the 1-2 plane will also be the same due to thermal expansion. Okay? This fact that has been highlighted is only true in the, if you choose the coordinate axis system coincident with the axis system where the material is orthotropic. If you want to do some coordinate transformation, then you can also have some shear strains. So now let us look at this relationship and try to explore further. So strain will be equal to, I'm only looking at plane stress in the 1-2 direction because I'm more interested in laminas. So strain is equal to compliance into stress plus delta T into thermal coefficients plus delta C into hygroscopic expansion coefficients. Alpha 1-2 is zero because in the orthotropic direction, thermal effects don't cause shear strains. Similarly, beta 1-2 is zero because effect of moisture does not cause shear strains in your orthotropic coordinate axis system. In term, if you invert this equation, it comes out to be something like this. Stress is equal to apparent stiffness into the strain as shown here. Okay. And we can also now use transformation equations. So the hygroscopic, the thermal strain can be transformed just like you transform other forms of strain. So you get relationship that thermal strain in the one epsilon yt. This is coming in exactly the same way as we had done strain transformation and coefficient transformations in my previous lecture. Okay, epsilon 1,2 is 0. So 0 is equal to, you get this term. Okay, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So in general, for a rotated plane stress, the with expansional strains, your equation will come out to be something like this. Stress in any arbitrary cross section, epsilon x, sigma y, sigma xy, will be equal to your apparent stiffness into these strains. But here we are also adding this term. This is the shear strain term. This is because my coordinate axis system has been rotated. So using all the relationships, I want you to go home and after the class, try to derive the expression for alpha x in terms of alpha 1, alpha 2. Okay, so please try to derive these three equations. This is the value of the coefficient of thermal expansion in different coordinate axis system. If the value of the thermal expansion coefficients are provided in the orthotropic coordinate axis system. Similarly, you can find out how the hygroscopic expansion coefficients will vary as a function of the direction cosines. Keep in mind that unlike the elastic constants which had m to the power 4 dependence, these constants only have an m square dependence. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, even though I have said in my previous slide that we can, the different strain components can be added, that the principle of linear superposition holds, but we have to be very careful about one thing, that the engineering constants or the stiffness coefficients, they in turn depends on the T and C. So while writing this equation and while generating the value of S matrix, you have to be careful that the appropriate choices of Young's modulus and other engineering constants are taken, because the engineering constants also depend on the temperature and moisture. So usually you are given a chart like this. Can everybody see slide 6?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So usually you will get a chart like this, where on the x-axis is temperature, y-axis is, let's say, tensile modulus. For different amounts of C, how does the modulus look like? How does the modulus change? So if my moisture content is 0%, my modulus is high. As the moisture content increases, the Young's modulus E1 decreases. It also depends on temperature. There's a very slight dependence. Okay, so you'll get, one of the two charts. Both of them are actually conveying the same information. In the first three charts on your left, you have temperature in the x-axis. Y-axis is the different modulus, E1, E2, G12, and different lines show you how the dependence is for different values of C, that is the humidity. On the right-hand side, X-axis is moisture content, Y-axis is tensile modulus, E1, E2, G12, for different temperatures. Like Young's modulus, E1 does not seem to depend so much on temperature, but Young's modulus in the two direction depends a lot on the different temperatures. This is, don't look at the numbers seriously, because I think all the, this is seemed meant to be as an illustrative example of how the charts look like and how the stiffness coefficients depend on the temperature. So if I go back to my first slide, it means that even the strain in the body due to the applied stress also depends on the temperature and moisture, because this S matrix depends on the temperature and moisture. We have to be careful that we take the appropriate engineering constants and also account for these expansional strains. So both of the things you have to do to get it correct. Okay? Can anybody look at these plots and guess whether this data is for carbon fiber composite materials or glass fiber composite materials. If this chart is given to you and you have to guess, what is your answer?
Carbon fiber composite. E1 and E2 are very much different.
But even for, no, even for glass fiber composites, it's very different. Na? You, carbon fiber is right, but E1, E2 is different even for glass also.
Sir, the value of tensile module.
This value, look, you have calculated now for a glass fiber, for a carbon fiber composites, modulus E1 was 116. It is somewhere in this range. Okay, good. Any doubts about what we have discussed so far? I think you already know what I have discussed, but hopefully this is a good recap.
Sir?
Yes.
So in the graph, it looks like that with increasing temperature, the modulus E1 is increasing. So actually, is it correct?
The scatter is very high. So I mean, per data point, they must have done 4-5 tests and there is so much scatter that it looks like it increases slightly. But it is marginal. Most likely, it should remain constant. E1 remains constant because E1 is mostly dependent on carbon fiber, and carbon fiber starts decaying only at very high temperatures. So it should be almost flatline. The slight trend upwards that you see is most likely due to the fact that many tests were done, and mean and standard deviation, there is some statistical scatter.
Okay, sir.
But I think you bring a good point. You see that E1 depends on temperature, E2 does not depend on temperature. Because the E1 properties are more or less dependent on the fibers, and carbon fibers are stable for much higher temperatures as compared to the matrix. E2 depends on the matrix. As the temperature increases, the matrix property degrades, fiber property does not change so much. So the Young's modulus E1 does not change so much, but the Young's modulus E2 will decay more significantly. Like going from room temperature, this is about 7, and at about 150 degrees Celsius or 420 Kelvin, this is only 25% or 33% of what it was at room temperature. E1 is more or less the same. Okay?
Yes, sir.
And these are the type of problems you can expect. So in this plot, you are seeing, so usually you are getting some values of Q, Q1, Q22, Q12, Q66. Alpha value is either given in text or a figure like this is given, which gives me the value of alpha per degree Fahrenheit or per degree Celsius, depending on the axis, and how it is varying as a function of temperature, as a function of theta. So you look at these charts, calculate the value of alpha, and the Q matrix is known, and delta T is known, you can calculate the expansional strength. Okay. Be careful, alpha 1 not equal to alpha 2, you have to take care of these things. It should be straightforward. Okay, is this clear?
Yes, sir.
So now this brings me more or less to the end of the solid mechanics recap, anisotropic elasticity that I wanted to discuss. So my next topic is, how do you quantify how much reinforcement is needed? Okay. So for example, you can have what is known as weight fraction. Weight fraction is commonly used by the manufacturers. They refer to how much is the weight of the fiber. In how much is the weight fraction of the fiber for the composite. Volume fraction is how much is the volume of the fiber. Manufacturers usually are more interested in the weight fraction. We mechanics people are more interested in the volume fraction. So if you buy a material, it's unlikely that you will be able to say, I want a composite material with this volume fraction. Most likely, the material supplier wants the weight fraction, not the volume fraction. And how to go from weight fraction to volume fraction? You can use a formula like this. If the density of the fiber and the matrix is known, and if the volume fraction is unknown, but the weight fraction is known, you can calculate it and vice versa. This is true for a two component, that is, there is fiber and matrix. Okay, so if you look at a handbook or if you look at the data sheet provided by a materials supplier, volume fraction will rarely be provided to you. Most of the times, weight fraction is given to you. And the relationship between volume and weight fraction is slightly non-linear. It depends on the relative density of the fiber and the matrix. So these are the charts for glass, carbon, and aramid fibers. Okay, I think this is straightforward, this weight and volume fraction. The next concept is what is known as aerial weight. Okay, aerial weight is the weight in gram of 1 meter square of reinforcement. So if you take the dry fibers, cut 1 meter square of it and weigh it, the weight in grams is known as aerial weight. This is also used a lot by the textile industry. Like for example, if you go to a Raymond shop and the shopkeeper tells you ki, this fabric is nice because its GSM is so and so, it means GSM means grams per square meter. He is usually referring to this aerial weight, that what is the weight if you take 1 square meter of that fabric. Similarly, for our fibers also, we use the same thing. And aerial weight depends on fiber density, bundle size, how you have weaved it, etc., etc. And it can vary from 50 gram or less or up to even 2000 grams for heavyweight fibers. By your material supplier. In mechanics, we don't have any expressions directly in terms of aerial weight. But if aerial weight is given to you, you can calculate the weight fraction, and from the weight fraction, you are expected to calculate the volume fraction. Now, what should be the thickness? Now, if you look at the two figures, both of them have equal number of fiber layers. Let's say they have 5 layers of fibers each. But if the matrix content is higher, then my laminate is thick. Lamina means one layer, more than one layer is laminate. Then my laminate is thick. So low fiber content leads to thick laminate. High fiber content leads to thin laminate. Okay. So the thickness of my laminate is inversely proportional to the fiber content. Is this clear concept?
Sir, for same strength, no?
For?
Same strength. We are comparing.
No, we are not looking at strength or stress. We are just looking at how to quantify the fiber content. This one is an example of two composite materials where one, there is high matrix content, and the other, there is low matrix content. And the fiber thickness is the same, and the fiber amount is the same. For the same amount of fiber, if matrix content is higher, my laminate will be thicker. If my matrix content is lower, my laminate will be thinner. Actually, yes, sir, we are trying to say, if you give me the fiber volume fraction and the number of layers, can I tell you what the thickness is? That is the purpose of this.
So, sir, we can make matrix thinner, no?
If you make matrix thinner, then the matrix content will be lower.
Okay, sir.
So we have this formula that the volume fraction is equal to number of layers into aerial weight divided by density of fiber divided by thickness. Okay. Or if the fiber content and everything is known, you can calculate the thickness as number of layers into aerial weight divided by density of fiber into volume fraction. These are important because as I said, it's very unlikely that the material supplier is going to give you the fiber volume fraction directly. But in all the formulas that we have learned so far, most of them require fiber volume fraction. So the aerial weight is given to you, the number of layers is given to you, thickness is given to you, density is given to you, you can calculate the fiber volume fraction. Or you can solve that, this is the aerial weight, this is the density, I want this much thickness, what is the number of layers do I need to put? So to solve problems like that, so these are problems that we are solving one step before the mechanics problem has started. The input for our mechanics problem is the volume fraction, but how to calculate the volume fraction? You will calculate using expressions such as this. Okay, so ply thickness and a fiber volume fraction, they'll vary non-linearly because it's 1 by inversely proportional. Similarly, ply thickness and fiber volume fraction for different aerial weights for glass and carbon fibers, similar non-linearity. Another thing is, if the aerial weight is high, for the same fiber volume fraction, the ply thickness is low. As the aerial weight increases, the ply thickness also increases. All this is coming directly from this formula. Okay. And what type of problems we can expect? Try to solve these two problems, please. It is simple application of the formula. Let me copy it. It says, what will be the thickness of a laminate consisting of two layers of 450 gram per meter square chop strand mat if the resin to glass ratio by weight is 2:1, density of fiber is 2 and 1 respectively. So what is the thickness? We want to calculate T. N is equal to 2. Aerial weight AW is 450 gram per meter square. Density of the fiber is 2. And volume fraction is not known. Volume, we know the weight fraction. Weight fraction is 2:1. So first, let us calculate the volume fraction. How will we do that? We will use the formula. First, using this formula, you can calculate the VF. And then use this formula and get the value of T. Please tell me, what is the value of T? While solving problems like this, please be careful about the unit. Sometimes the density is given in kg per meter cube or some other unit. Everything has to be in grams per centimeter. So the relative density of fiber and matrix, while calculating the fiber volume fraction, the units don't matter as long as they are consistent. But when you are trying to calculate the thickness, then you have to be careful that the density and is in grams per meter square, not grams per centimeter square. Otherwise, there is problems in the dimensions. N is unitless, aerial weight is grams per meter square, density also has to be grams per centimeter square, centimeter cube. Then the T will come in terms of centimeter. If you use grams per meter square, sorry, aerial weight is grams per meter square, density also has to be grams per meter cube. Only then you will get your thickness in meter. solving problems like this, this is area of error number one. Area of error number two is sometimes you are expected to calculate the number of layers. And the number of layers has to be zero. 0.9 millimeters Rahul is getting. Anybody? It's
0.09 centimeters.
I think it is 0.97 millimeters. So the other point I was trying to make is when you try to calculate, one of the type of problems you get is that you have to calculate the number of layers, and be careful that the number of layers has to be a whole number. So sometimes you will get a situation where you solve the number of layers and you get 4.7. So you cannot write number of layers is 4.7. The correct answer is going to be either 4 or 5. So how do you find out whether it is 4 or 5? Usually while making composite lamina, we prefer even number as compared to odd number. So we will write the answer typically is the nearest even number. So 4. So if the answer is 4.7 number of layers, then the correct answer should actually be 4.
So why we prefer even number?
We prefer even, that you will find out, I think, when we learn the classical lamination theory, because we want everything to balance. Above the central layer, if there is some minus 45 degree layer, below also should be minus 45 degree layer. If it is unbalanced, then you can expect a lot of out of plane shears, and those composite materials are slightly, they don't perform as well. We will have more discussion on this when we learn classical lamination theory. Okay. Okay. And what is the answer of the second question? This is straightforward. N is 3, AW is 800, thickness is 2 millimeters, be careful. Rho F is 2 gram per centimeter cube. Put everything same units. What is the fiber volume fraction? I think 0.6 is correct. Typically, that is the answer we can expect. Okay, so this brings me to the end of the topics that I wanted to discuss. Tomorrow we will solve some problems and we will look at an industrial test case, and our exam is on Tuesday. Okay, is there any questions about today's lecture?
Sir, please upload the recap of SAG.
So all the presentation, I will put it into one.
Yes, sir.
And I will.
Sir, the last time you didn't upload.
I forgot. Actually, my lecture was in. You should have reminded me before also. Message bhej sakte. You can send me message. So the half the presentation is in my laptop, half is in my PC, in my computer today. I will stitch everything today. I will 100% upload it.
And sir, what will the course for the test and the for the bio?
Till today, whatever we have learned.
Till today, not half. Okay, sir.
Tomorrow we will solve numerical. Maybe we will solve a numerical problems and we will discuss a industrial test case.
That will be not the course.
Problems will be syllabus, but yeah, industrial test case will not be the syllabus.
Okay, sir.